Bygone Gosport is brought to you in conjunction with GA Day Limited, Portsmouth's leading builders merchant, now in Whitworth Road, Gosport. The towns of Gosport and Fareham and the surrounding area, from Porchester to Lee-On-The Solent, have a rich heritage which is well documented and recorded. This video programme is not a comprehensive history of the area, it's more of a magazine of the past, a collection of often rare or unique film clips from widely differing sources, which let us reflect on long forgotten images as seen through the eyes of local filmmakers at the time. We hope you enjoy these films now as much as they did then, and start with a sequence entitled Across the Water. Situated adjacent to and to the east of the southern end of Portsea Island, Gosport has had many different ferry services connecting it with Portsmouth since at least as far back as the reign of Queen Elizabeth I. In those days, the service was provided by individual watermen who rowed passengers and their animals across the harbour for as little as a penny, though extra was charged during rougher conditions. The two short sequences seen here were taken in the 1930s and 1960s and give a good impression of the sometimes crowded conditions on the sturdy little ferry boats. During this time, the ferry was the quickest and cheapest way to get to Portsmouth, particularly for the many dockyard workers who packed the boats every morning and afternoon, together with their many bicycles, all stacked together on deck, although not always in an entirely orderly fashion. Across on the Portsmouth side, a familiar sight, as the ferry pulled in, was the antics of the mudlarks, children who dived into the mud at low tide to retrieve the pennies thrown to them from the ferries and the pontoon. The original road bridge linking the Royal Naval Hospital at Hasler with the centre of Gosport was first built in 1834. At the beginning of the Second World War, its centre span was removed to allow better access to Hasler Creek, specifically to Gumboat Yard, where motor torpedo boats and fast patrol boats were repaired. Bombing later damaged the bridge, and a high-level footbridge was erected over the old one. The new footbridge, exposed to the elements as it was immediately dubbed Pneumonia Bridge by locals, as it was said that if you did not have pneumonia before you started across, you surely would by the time you reached the other side. The remains of the old bridge can still be seen in this footage, as can the high-rise flats built in the 1960s on Trinity Green. Although the old bridge was deemed to be beyond repair after the Second World War, it was many years before the new single-carriage road bridge, controlled by traffic lights, was finally opened. The 3rd of July 1921 was a great day for Gosport. Huge crowds turned out in their Sunday best to welcome Earl Haig, hero and World War I veteran. He was visiting the town to inspect the newly formed Gosport branch of the British Legion. He's seen arriving in style at the Criterion Theatre in Fortin Road and inspecting the members of the British Legion who had served in the Great War, many proudly displaying their medals and other decorations. Later in the day, Earl Haig laid the foundation stone of what would become the much-loved Gosport War Memorial Hospital in Bury Road. In these memorable shots, both the ordinary folk and the great and good from around about the area gathered to see and hear the distinguished visitor. A little less than 2 years later, and the new hospital, built on what was previously rural farmland, was completed. It had been funded largely by public subscription, truly the People's War Memorial. Again, huge crowds turned out for the memorable occasion of its grand opening. Local Member of Parliament, Sir John Davidson, performed the opening ceremony, which was followed by a blessing and short service of dedication, conducted by the Rector of Alverstoke, Canon Guy Landon. Thank you. Since that time, the hospital has served the community for over 70 years, and the long-standing League of Friends of the hospital has raised many thousands of pounds to contribute to the huge transformation of the old building, such that today it still plays its part in providing local health care as part of the modern health service. It was over 30 years ago when local filmmaker Vic Nell decided to preserve on film the area around North Street in the Old Town Centre. The redevelopment plan was quite extensive and controversial at the time, sweeping away as it did many aspects of the fortified seaport town that Gosport once was. Seahorse Street disappeared in the redevelopment together with the Seahorse Pub, although the adjacent brewery had already been converted to residential use. Both are commemorated in the housing development that sprang up to replace the little narrow streets nearby. In these clips, we see many no doubt fondly remembered shops, such as Murphy's, the Ironmonger's, and Aladdin's Cave of familiar household items, many of them, like the shop itself, gone forever in today's age of plastics. A 100 years ago, there were over 50 pubs in the town centre, one of the few remaining being the Fox, which is today the oldest surviving pub, dating back to the 18th century. Blundell's, once the Crown, a famous old coaching inn, is now part of the Crown Mews development. The former inn has been handsomely restored for both residential and commercial use. The ballroom at the rear was once used as a favourite local meeting place and theatre. Perhaps some viewers have fond memories of evenings out there many years ago. Clarence Square School, built before the First World War, was closed in the 1950s, and by the time this film was taken, had been turned to commercial use several years before. And probably most famous of the buildings on the harbour, Porchester Castle, lies on the site of a Roman encampment, commanding the land and the sea as protection against early invaders. A Belgian sailor, Carausius, appointed by the Romans, is credited with the building of the castle, which has walls up to 10 feet thick, which rise above the surrounding low-lying marshy land. Carausius was an ambitious man and had himself proclaimed emperor, but was later murdered by a jealous rival. In later times, Queen Elizabeth and many other monarchs slept there on their way to expeditions to France, or sometimes just for relaxation and pleasure. In 1535, Henry VIII and Anne Boleyn spent a holiday at the castle, where they were very merry and hawked daily. It was only a year later that Anne Boleyn lost her head. By the end of the 18th century, the castle's main use was as a prison, and it was becoming somewhat decayed. It was briefly considered by the Admiralty's commissioners for the sick and wounded as a possible site for a naval hospital. Serving sailors for the past 200 years have had cause to be grateful for the commissioner's final decision to commence a new build at Hasler instead. Local filmmaker David Bryant was responsible for shooting these colourful scenes in the castle grounds on the occasion of the crowning of the May Queen in 1960. The following year was to be the last time this ceremony was conducted, having been resuscitated at the start of the 1950s. Some eagle-eyed viewers may be able to pick out their younger selves in these scenes of cheerful celebration. The brightly coloured costumes are in stark contrast to the massive grey walls and battlements of the ancient castle. For one day at least, scenes reminiscent of hundreds of years ago again filled the castle with bustle and activity. Looking at these images, we can see that the ancient castle is not simply a monument to the past, but on occasions such as this is seen to be very much a part of the local community. Indeed, an integral part of life around the harbour it was originally built to defend. The cooperative movement was particularly strong around Portsmouth in the early decades of this century. Its large head office and department store in Fratton Road was one of the largest in the country after its rebuilding in the 1930s, following the major fire that destroyed the previous store. Branches sprang up everywhere, further and further afield from Portsea Island. Here we see Lee-On-The Solent getting its first glimpse of branch number 43 during the opening at number 5 the High Street on the 14th of August 1935. If you look closely, you can see the blinds in the shop window slowly rise as Mr. R.W. White declares the branch open for business. Notice also the two Cub Scouts passing by in uniform, the lady in the bath chair surveying the scene from the rear of the crowd, and a few moments later, a pony and trap going past down the high street. Lee, of course, had had a thriving high street since late Victorian times, when John Newton Robinson, a London property developer, saw the potential of the town as a resort and subsequently created much of commercial benefit to the town and encouraged others to invest locally in the property boom of the period. As befits a naval and military town, the Queen's Jubilee in 1977 was cause for much local celebration, including a number of colourful events with a service flavour. The official civic ceremonies, some of which we shall see in a moment, were only one part of the local celebrations. Around the town, residents had put out the flags and bunting, laid the tables, and enjoyed their own street parties. At Stokes Bay and Lee-On-The Solent, crowds turned out to catch a glimpse of the fleet review at Spithead. And although the weather was less than perfect, they were rewarded for their efforts with some splendid memories of one of the largest peacetime armadas ever seen in the Solent. At Peel Common, it seems the mayoral chain was rather outshone by the presence of the pearly King and Queen, Mr. and Mrs. Seymour. A junior gun crew was recruited to provide a salute, and the Cumberland Guard added their own military touch to the occasion. Gosport's High Street was the focus for a formal march past of all the services located within the borough. The Town Hall provides the backdrop to the saluting platform as the Mayor, Councillor Tom Keith, flanked by senior service officials, takes the salute, watched by a large crowd of fellow citizens, many of whom no doubt have close family ties with the armed services. Many local organisations brought out their floats for a grand carnival procession, led by the mayor, and here seen in Foughton Road. In the background can be seen the well-known entrance gate to St Vincent's College buildings. The opening shots seen in these extracts start at the boundary between the boroughs of Gosport and Fareham at Hoeford. This film, an extract from a 30-minute film made by Gosport Borough in 1959, shows that the road entering into Gosport is almost empty of traffic. Such a tranquil scene is almost unimaginable in today's road conditions. At this time, the town was approaching a watershed in its development. The shoreline and the ferry gardens would remain much as they always were, but the end of the high street was about to lose many of its old buildings, including the market house and the dive cafe, the Northumberland and Isle of Wight Hoy public houses, and the gas showrooms. Other old friends went the same way. Clarence Square, one of the architectural gems of old Gosport, was sacrificed to make way for necessary commercial development. Out at Alverstoke, Bay House, once the home of the wealthy and prestigious Barings family, became the new base for Gosport Grammar School, which had outgrown its Walpole Road buildings. Modern extensions to Bay House meant the loss of some woodland, but today the comprehensive school boasts perhaps the finest campus in the south, with its splendid outlook across Stokes Bay to the Isle of Wight. Off South Street, the open-air swimming pool still attracted hundreds of swimmers and sunbathers, as it had since 1935. At 75 yards long, with a cascade, chute, children's paddling pool, sun terraces, and Art Deco cafe, it was, in its day, one of the finest outdoor pools along the south coast. In the early 1980s, the whole complex was demolished and the pool filled in. During the 1960s, one keen cine film enthusiast made a simple record of the comings and goings around the Fort Wallington Tavern on Wallington Shore Road. Indeed, many of these shots appear to be taken from the upstairs windows of the pub itself. No doubt many recognise these views, mostly taken just shortly before the new A27, A32 link road was built nearby, which shows us a village life that in many ways had remained largely unchanged for much of this century. The traffic flows gently over the bridge. A frisky cow goes on a village walkabout. And Mr. Roper, the cutler, reminds us of the lost skills of craftsmen of days gone by. The River Wallington played its part in attracting early settlers to this part of Hampshire, sheltered by Portsdown Hill as it is, and with rich agricultural land surrounding the settlement that became known as Fareham. For a small rural community, Wallington had had several important industries in former times. Tanning and brewing provided the locals with secure employment in the last century, for example. but in more recent times, the residents have often locked horns with the powers that be in the effort to keep the unique village atmosphere protected from overdevelopment. As Fareham continued to expand and demand greater access to and from Portsmouth, there were real fears that Wallington would disappear completely under the pressure of modern traffic schemes and housing development. The snowy scenes included here give us a picture postcard view of the village, but these shots were taken in April 1966, when an unseasonably cold snap caught many unprepared. Look closely and you can see someone walking on the River Wallington whilst it's frozen over. It's business as usual though for the beer deliveries. Perhaps the locals found their ale a little colder that day, but probably welcomed it nonetheless after throwing snowballs at each other outside. Today the residents of Wallington can be said to have prevailed in that as the traffic thunders along close by on the A27, the small community on the River Wallington has held its ground and still retains much of its village atmosphere. After the thaw comes the flood, as the riverbanks gave way to the high water level, a fact of life that Wallington has had to face many times in its long history. Much of old Gosport disappeared in the 1960s, but many of the well-loved local landmarks still remain. St Vincent's Sixth Form College in Foughton Road was originally Foughton Barracks when it was built in 1847 as the home of the Royal Marine Light Infantry. In 1922, when the RMLI moved out, the barracks remained in service hands as the St Vincent Boys Training School until bought by Hampshire County Council for Gosport's fourth comprehensive school, later to become the Sixth Form College. This film was taken between tenants. We can still see the lower half of the huge mast and its stays used for rehearsing the manning the mast ceremonies. Very little of the barracks complex remains intact today, with the exception of the tall clock tower entrance and guard buildings in Foughton Road. The splendid cast iron and glass canopy which once graced the entrance to the officers' wardroom was saved by being moved and re-erected at HMS Collingwood. Holy Trinity Church and its fine vicarage building are still with us and survey the harbour entrance to the town, framed by the tall buildings of the modern flats. Further up the town in Bury Road, the Gosport Waterworks Tower, built in 1866, was a prominent local feature for over 100 years, bringing fresh water to the citizens of Gosport from the Meon Valley to the north. The Waterworks Tower was built with typical Victorian style and was often referred to as Gosport Castle as a result. In Spring Garden Lane, the mainline railway station was opened in 1841, almost 7 years earlier than Portsmouth's. Designed by Sir William Tite, its 14 columns are still there, but sadly very little else, although even in its ruinous state, it's still a very impressive structure. It was finally closed in 1966, a victim of the beaching cuts. And today, Gosport is one of the few towns of its size and importance not to have its own railway terminus. Happily, the original early Victorian Penfold pillar box is still in its original position outside the station railings and is still in regular use. The delightful scenes that follow evoke instant memories, perhaps tinged with a little sadness. Tom Parker Dairies, one of Hampshire's oldest established dairies, were about to move to a completely motorised fleet for deliveries, having dispensed with most of the horse-drawn milk floats. Perhaps it was their own nostalgia for days gone by that caused them to keep one last horse-drawn float on the road. But this day, in June 1964, was to be the very last round delivered by horsepower. Perhaps here is the last daily link between the urban and the rural being broken as the world moves on. We're taken through West Street and along the High Street, where the delivery man is clearly a familiar and friendly face. Tom Parker had built his business up from small beginnings as a farmer, who later realized that delivering his own produce and cutting out the middleman was the way to go. From those small beginnings, Tom Parker's dairy at Cam's Alders became a well-known institution familiar to locals for almost as long as anyone can remember. One wonders whether the horse stopped for a pint of beer on a daily basis, but certainly nobody could begrudge it if the deliveries were a little late on this very special day. The scenes of open fields towards the end of this clip remind us how relatively rural Fareham was until fairly recent times. One wonders whether the horses knew their working lives were over, but at least they had a peaceful and well cared for retirement. Whilst the new electric floats were efficient and economical, no doubt many people mourned the passing of the horse-drawn dairy floats. The sight of driver and horse had for decades provided an opportunity to stop the housework and have a quick chat with the driver whilst considering the day's dairy order. But throughout his life, Tom Parker had always been one to look to the future and embrace progress. And sentimentality aside, the world had moved on. And Tom Parker's deliveries had to move on with it. Boats of all sorts are in Gosport's lifeblood, whether it be messing about in them or actually building them. The The world-renowned firms of Camper & Nicholson's and Ratsey & Lapthorne's were particularly famous for the J-class yachts, beloved of wealthy yachting enthusiasts. Campers designed and built the yachts. Ratsey's made the huge sails. The scene here is of Camper & Nicholson's slipway in 1936, as the 135-foot Endeavour II, built for the millionaire yachtsman and aviator, Tommy Sopworth, slides into the water for the first time. Endeavour II was designed to be Sopworth's challenger for the America's Cup, held in 1937. During the races themselves, the results were flashed onto an illuminated board in Ferry Gardens, so that commuters could follow the fortunes of Gosport's proud challenger for the yachting world's most sought-after trophy. But despite everyone's high hopes for the yacht's success, in the event, despite a couple of very good starts by Endeavour, the American yacht Ranger won all four races. Yacht racing of an altogether smaller type of vessel has taken place in Walpole Park's yachting pond over many years. These events had immense popularity and attracted crowds of enthusiasts for this, perhaps the most soothing of marine racing sports, held against the backdrop of the old town, the trees and the green of the former town ramparts. Indeed, models on this very water played a vital role in grander schemes, as it was used in the 20s and 30s to test model versions of the J-class yacht, like that seen being launched a few moments ago. A part of Walpole Park was developed for a council housing scheme in the 1960s. Town's yachting history, several roads in the new development, such as Nairio Way, Endeavour Close and Astra Close, were named after famous Camper & Nicholson yachts of the past. The original commentary recorded when this film was made has been left intact in the following sequence.
We in Gosport have grown used to the sight and sound of hovercraft, having had a regular passenger service to the Isle of Wight since 1965 and a summer service since 1962. To show the world the progress made so far since this new form of transport was invented only 9 years ago, the first ever hover show was held at Browndown on the Solent, the home of the hovercraft industry. The SRN1 first lifted off in June 1959 and is the forerunner of all the craft here today. It is shortly to be installed in the British Science Museum. To show the capabilities of these craft, we are shown two models. This one is a radio-controlled model of the proposed cross-channel SRN4, which will weigh 160 tons. Principle can also be applied to monorail travel, and using linear induction propulsion, the full-scale version of this model would be capable of speeds up to 250 miles an hour. A Britten-Norman CC2, powered by two modified Rolls-Royce Silver Shadow car engines, one of the quietest craft in the show. The Westland SRN3 is currently the largest hovercraft in the world. Weighing 25 tons, it is capable of a speed of 75 knots, carrying 150 fully armed troops. This SRN-5 shows the drift encountered in high-speed manoeuvring, which, unlike aircraft, is uncontrollable. However, a 3-foot obstacle holds no terrors. To show the military potential of these craft, a commando raid was organized. And since this show, many hovercraft have been ordered by the Army for the purpose of forming a unit. With all the excitement, let us not forget the normal commercial uses of the hovercraft and feel grateful to Christopher Cockerill for yet another British invention.
The tower at Lee-On-The Solent was sadly destined to have become something of a white elephant by the time it was demolished in 1971. But way back in 1937, when it was built, much was expected of the Lee Tower complex. A fine ballroom, restaurant, cafes and a snug little cinema all seemed set fair to help promote Lee as a modern progressive seaside resort in the days before foreign package holidays, when the South Coast, with its milder climate and with easy access to the Isle of Wight, was a popular destination for many family holidays. Unhappily for Lee, when the tower was built, war clouds were already gathering in Europe. And so, by the late 1940s, Lee Tower and its many fine amenities had lost the battle against the brighter attractions of larger resorts such as Southsea and Brighton. The cinema and the ballroom remained popular, and were in use up until 1960, when the appeal of regular nights out at the cinema started to be taken over by nights in with the television. During the war years, the 100-foot tower played a key role in the build-up to D-Day, as it was home of COTUG, a military unit responsible for the tug and towing services needed in association with the invasion force assembling at Spithead in 1944. The complex had later become a burden to the borough council, and parts of it were hived off to private enterprise to see if they could be made to pay their way before the final decision was taken to demolish the whole site. With the disappearance of the tower, Lee sadly lost not only many fine amenities, but also one of the most distinctive landmarks anywhere on the South Coast. These scenes recapture the old Fareham that has long since passed. The redevelopment of West Street in the 1960s and 1970s, with the introduction of the undercover shopping mall, changed the face of the former market town with its wide streets and its Monday livestock market. Passing floats seen here are believed to be from the 1935 carnival, which was held in celebration of King George V's Silver Jubilee in that year. Look carefully, and it may be possible to make out some of the names of well-known local shops and suppliers in the background. length of West Street is filled with lively procession of floats and enthusiastic onlookers. As in so many public scenes captured on film in the 1920s and 30s, the Fareham crowd is well dressed, with hats, suits, and general Sunday best being much in evidence. The well-turned-out little girl in the foreground by the parked cars is no doubt typical of how a great many mothers would have wished to see their daughters dressed on a public occasion such as the celebration of this significant royal event. We hope you've enjoyed this programme and these glimpses of bygone events, people and places from the past of Gosport and the surrounding area. Much of the film in this programme was shot by local filmmakers and amateur cine enthusiasts. If you have any old cine film, no matter what the subject, age or quality, it may be of interest to other people, just as this has been, so please do not hesitate to contact us. We leave you with a roundup of snippets from the cutting room floor, so to speak, and hope you'll recognise some of these scenes as we bid you farewell. Thank you for watching. G.A. Day, Portsmouth's leading builders merchants, was established in 1919 by George Day, who later became Lord Mayor of Portsmouth. Since those early days, the company has grown and developed under the continuous direction of the Day family. We are proud to be a leading supplier of building materials to local tradesmen and major contractors throughout the area, together with homeowners and residents who find materials for their DIY and gardening needs here, where our skilled and knowledgeable staff are on hand to assist. Our commitment to serving all our customers is represented by our policy of holding the widest possible range of stock in sufficient quantities to supply the most demanding of building, DIY or gardening projects. Whether in the DIY department or garden centre, paint and decorating section, supplies warehouse or out in the heavy materials yard, our aim is to supply all your needs in a timely manner, from stock at hand. We have dedicated retail staff, as well as a specialist sales office team, to help you plan the flow of materials for any development contract. Of course, our experience as merchants is available to our retail customers, so they get the best advice available for their projects. In the kitchen and bathroom showrooms, our in-house design consultants will help you plan your kitchen or bathroom from the large range of styles and designs available from our selected manufacturers. Our main depot and head office is at Burfields Road, Portsmouth, and with two further branches at West Street, Fareham, and Whitworth Road.